while millions all over this planet are dying of spiritual thirst. We are greedy and selfish in our ways. But Father, I heard you say that if my people who are called by your name will humble themselves and pray, you will hear our prayers and give us water that will satisfy the sea.
Jesus.
Never.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to worship, all of you. I don't see any new faces out there, but if you're with us as a guest, thank you for joining us for worship this morning. If you are with us as a guest, there are yellow guest information cards. They're in that card holder in front of you. We'd love for you to fill it out, and we'd love a way of keeping in contact with you. But again, welcome all of you. If you haven't taken a look at your bulletin, please do so. I want to highlight just a few of the announcements. If you haven't taken the spiritual experience and interest survey, we've been offering it online this Sunday, and probably for the next couple Sundays, we're going to offer a print version. And so it just takes a couple minutes. Appreciate if you could fill that out. And leave it, I guess you could just leave it back on the table as you leave this morning. Be sure to put your contact information on that also. Our virtual choir is going to do one more piece, so see the announcement about that. Brenda's putting that together along with Alex Miller. And also next Sunday, the 15th, we're going to have the blessing of our backpacks. School year starts, boy, just in a couple weeks, so we're going to have the blessing of our backpacks next Sunday, the 15th, so just note that. Other announcements, please see them all. A lot of things are going on as we gear up for the new school year. There are prayer request cards in that card holder as well. They look like this. We'd love to pray with you and for you, so if you have a prayer request, please let us know. If you circle that you'd like it shared with the congregation, we'll be sure to list it in our weekly prayer concerns that's found in that other insert in your bulletin. So we're going to continue our worship this morning with some verses from Psalm 115. I'll read the leader's part, invite you to join me in the people's part. Psalm 115, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. For the sake of your steadfast love and faithfulness, why should the nations say, where is their God? Our God is in the heavens. Wherever God pleases, God does. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. They have mouths but do not speak, eyes but do not see. They have ears but do not hear, noses but do not smell. They have hands but do not feel, feet but do not walk, throats but make no sound. Those who make idols are like them. So are all who trust in them. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. The Lord is their help and their shield. Let's pray. God, as we come to you, you are our help, our shield. Lord, help us to forget the worries of this day, the list of things to do, and just focus our hearts, our minds, our spirits on worshiping you this morning. We gather and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's bless his name this morning. You can stand if you want. You can sit, whatever worship posture you want. We're just going to praise our God.
Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, with streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Thank you.
His name is the name above every name, always and forever. And we're going to teach you a new song this morning. It's got great promises of who God is and who He is for each of us every day.
worship, and we'll just spend a few moments of prayer as the praise team plays. I just invite you to prepare your hearts for what God has in store for us today as we spend time growing closer to Him. God, we know that You have made a way for us, and sometimes, obviously, God, it's hard for us to see that way or to feel that way, but we know that You have prepared for us a seat at Your table, and that You have walked with us through the valleys, through the mountaintops, and how great it is to know that we are not alone on this journey of life and faith. And Lord God, I just ask that You would hear our cries of worship this morning as we pause to celebrate and to give thanks for all the blessings that are in our midst, those seen and unseen, that we might take note. So God, fill our hearts and our souls with Your presence so that we might embody who You are. And as we continue in this time of prayer, we lift up the names again in our insert. We ask for healing for David and for Tom, for Cheryl, for Jill, for Eric, for Sam, for Jerry, for Michael, for Jack, for Mary, for Jesse, and for Leanne, and for any others, oh God, who might be on our hearts. May You be with them as You are with us tonight, this morning, whatever it is. And God, I invite us to continue in this time of celebration as we pray together as one, the Lord's Prayer. And I invite you, congregation, to pray it with me if you know it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Tim, and thanks to the praise band for leading us, and thanks to Doug Meek for filling in last Sunday in my absence. I was away with my two sons and my two grandsons, and we had a wonderful weekend. My grandsons are almost 5 and almost 4, and they're at that age where they're just beginning to be more and more fun, and so it was a good weekend. But again, thanks to Doug for filling in. You know, I marvel at just the gifts and the level of competence of our staff, our directors. It's a privilege to work with them. But you know, friends, you can have the greatest directors in the world, like an orchestra can have the greatest conductor in the world, a team can have the greatest coach. They can find an army can have the greatest commander, but unless the soldiers or the players or the musicians sort of step up, it really doesn't matter how strong, how competent, how talented your leaders are. It's the lay folk, it's the folk in the pew that wisely manage all that God has given you of your time and your talent and your treasure. And we call that management of all that God has given us. We talk about Christian stewardship. And in fact, if we wanted to get technical about it, really everything we have, including our life itself, is a gift from God. And as believers, as stewards, we have been entrusted. We are responsible. We are accountable to God to manage and use wisely everything that God has given us. And stewardship is really how we fulfill that promise that many of us made when we joined this church to uphold it by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. And stewardship, in a nutshell, it's really what you do after you say, I believe. After you make a profession of faith in Christ, it's what you do. And so I trust that if you haven't already taken that survey, the experience and interest survey that we've been pushing for the last few weeks, I know some of you already have, but if you haven't, would you please take the time to fill it out? We would really appreciate it. I'm guessing some of you are probably thinking, well, you know, I'm not going to bother because it's just a big waste of time. Well, literally, it takes a couple minutes is all it takes. You can even fill it out while you're listening to the sermon. I don't really care. Some of you are probably thinking, you know, I don't want to do that because I don't want them to know what I'm experienced at or what I'm interested in, because if I do, you know, then they're going to ask me to do something. They're going to ask me to serve. They're going to ask me to serve on a committee or some area of ministry. Well, yeah, we are. But we might also use you as a resource for somebody else. If you've got the experience and somebody else does it, we might partner you with somebody that you might help share your experience with someone else that we ask. But I want you to think about it this way. You know, in the Holy Lands, there are two bodies of water. There's the Sea of Galilee up to the north. That's the little blue blob at the top of the map. The Dead Sea is the other. It's down there at the bottom. And there's a lot of difference, a huge difference between the Dead Sea and the Sea of Galilee. And the reason the Dead Sea is called the Dead Sea is because it's filled with minerals and deposits. Everything runs into the Dead Sea to the point that there's no life at all. There's no fish, there's no plant life, there's nothing. It's so filled with deposits and minerals that life can't exist. On the other hand, the Sea of Galilee, there's mountains to the north that all the streams and runoff run into the Sea of Galilee, and the Sea of Galilee is teeming with life. And the reason it's teeming with life is not only does water run in, but water runs out. Water flows out into the Jordan River, and it's a very fertile river valley. And you see the difference? The Dead Sea, everything just settles. Nothing flows out. And it's dead. The Sea of Galilee is full of life because not only does life flow in, but life flows out. See, friends, that's how it's supposed to be for us as followers of Jesus. We've been given so much. We've been blessed so richly. It's not meant for us to keep and to hoard for our own enjoyment and our own pleasure. It's meant to be shared. It's meant to be used in service to God and others. It's meant to be given. And that's where life and vitality and blessing from God happens. Most of you probably heard the name Samuel F.B. Morse, the great inventor, Morse code, telegraph. He was a renowned university professor. He was also a dedicated Christian. A lot of people don't know that. In fact, it's recorded that he always prayed. Morse was a very, very prayerful man. He prayed that God would give him insight and understanding as he conducted his experiments in his laboratory. In fact, late in life, he said, "When flattering honors came to me in my many inventions, I never felt I deserved them. I had made a valuable application of electricity, not because I was superior to other men or other people, but solely because God, who meant it for humankind, must reveal it to someone, and he was pleased to reveal it to me." And so, you know, Morris reminds us of the truth is that life is a gift. It's meant to be shared. It's meant to be stewarded. And friends, each and every one of us has a responsibility to use what God has given us, whatever it is, to serve Him and to serve others. And I think each of us will be held accountable before God of how we use those things. In fact, I think that many of the gifts and the blessings that God has given us, I think are a test in this life of true faith and allegiance. We live and think as though this life is all there is. And all these blessings and all this stuff that we have will last forever. The Bible teaches us very clearly that nothing in this world, friends, we take with us. We enter into this world with nothing, we leave it. And you've heard it said before, you don't see a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer. I never have. Because our relationship with material possessions and wealth will end when this life ends. So, you know, as much as these possessions and things that we have, these gifts we have, they're not eternal, I think they have eternal consequences. They have eternal significance. And many of the ways that we use the things that God has given us will determine the eternity we're preparing for ourselves. That's why Jesus said, "Don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven." I was reading the other day about an aqueduct that the Romans built in a place called Segovia, Spain. They built it back in the year 109 AD. And for 18 centuries, it carried water, cool, fresh water from the mountains above down to the city below. For 60 generations, people drank of the water of its flow. Until a generation came along and said, you know what, we need to preserve this great marvel, this great feat of Roman engineering. And so they decided to lay pipe. And so they relieved this ancient aqueduct of its burden of carrying water. And you know what happened? Within just a matter of months, the mortar began to dry, the bricks began to crumble, it began to sag, it threatened to fall. What ages of service couldn't do, idleness did in just a few days. And friends, that's the underlying principle of Christian service and stewardship. If you don't use it for its intended purpose, why God gave it, you lose it. And what we have, we should give honor and glory to God. And I believe this principle applies to each and every one of us. Not just those of us who are blessed to be compensated, but every member of the body of Christ. Every one of us has a responsibility to serve in the body of Christ. There's a Christian author, historian by the name of Charles Kahn. He wrote about a man in the South who lived or visited Atlanta, Georgia. And Kahn writes this. He goes, when I lived in Atlanta several years ago, I noticed in the Yellow Pages, in the listings of restaurants, a place called the Church of God Grill. The particular name aroused my curiosity, so I dialed the number. A man answered the phone cheerily, "Hello, Church of God Grill." I asked, how was this restaurant given such an unusual name? And he told me, "Well, we used to have a little church down here. We started selling chicken dinners after worship each Sunday to help pay the bills. People liked the chicken, and we did such a good business that eventually we cut back on our worship service and just focused on chicken dinners. After a while, we just closed down the church altogether and kept serving chicken dinners. That's what we called it, the Church of God Grill." I guess my point is, friends, whatever we focus on, that's what we prioritize. If we're not careful, we could be like the Church of God Grill, with our focus and our priority leaving to the elimination of what our purpose is. You know, I'm old enough, and I'm probably going to, you know, give away my age, but, you know, I'm old enough to remember those full-service gas stations. Bobby Matthews had a Sinclair station 4 houses down from my house on West Main Street in Cardington, where I grew up. And especially in the summer times, man, that was the neighborhood hangout. We bought bottles of pop and Klondike bars and candy bars. Bobby Matthews had this little bicycle tire repair set up in one of his bays. We didn't even have to ask Bobby if we had a flat tire on our bike. We could just go in, you know, tear it apart, fix the flat. It was the local hangout. But I remember distinctly as a kid, you know, my parents had this, I don't know, a 62 Chevy Impala. It was red with a white stripe. It was a nice car. And I remember my dad or my mom, they would pull in, the bell would ding, ding. They didn't even have to get out of their car. His attendants came out wearing their, you know, colored coveralls with their tire gauge and pin and their pocket protector. One of them would wash the windshield, one of them would raise the hood, check the oil, while the other filled the tank of gas. And I remember my mom or my dad distinctly, if they missed a spot on the windshield, it was like, "Oh, you missed a spot, fix that." But it was a full service gas station. You didn't even have to get out of your car. And friends, unfortunately, that's how some of us are with this church. We come in and we sit down and we say, "I'm here. Wait on me and serve me." We don't lift a finger. We don't get out of our cars. We don't serve. It's not the way it's supposed to be. You're not intended to just to come in here and hear hymns and sing hymns and hear music and hear messages and then walk away thinking, ah, I've been served. We're meant to serve. In fact, I got to believe that when some of us go church hopping, we've got a mental list in our minds of things that we expect churches to do for us and serve us on that list. But friends, somewhere in this journey of faith, a change has to happen. And I don't know exactly how it happens. I don't know where it happens. Some of us might be able to point to a specific date or event or whatever, but somehow, somewhere, as Christians, we need to find ourselves moving from serve us to service. Where the church is no longer a place where we go to be served, but to serve. James writes this, "What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them?" He continues, "In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead." So where's your faith? I think the Lord wants us to be a full-service station where everyone is an attendant. Everyone is serving. The needs of this congregation, the needs of our community. What a beautiful metaphor. A full-service faith station for Wadsworth, Ohio, and beyond. What a picture. In fact, in 2 Chronicles, it says, "The eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him." Do His eyes focus on you? Do they land on you? Are you committed to using all that God has given you to serve this church? You know, Jesus put a completely different spin on it. He tells a parable in the end of Matthew's gospel, the 25th chapter. Some of you know it. It's a parable about the final judgment. It's a parable about how Jesus divides the obedient, the true follower from the pretender. And the criteria that Jesus will use according to this parable is how we put our faith into action, how our mouths and our words became actions. Basic acts of mercy, feeding the hungry, giving water to the thirsty, being kind to the stranger, clothing the naked, looking after the sick. And according to this parable, friends, we're judged less on what we said and what we did and more on what we failed to do. It's like the young couple from the hills of Appalachia. They got involved in this church where there was a lot of shouting and jumping and clapping in the aisles, right? They were trying to convince old grandma to come to their church. The grandson said, "Grandma, you should have seen it. The Spirit of God, oh, it was there. The music was rocking. It was awesome." Grandma just kept rocking in her chair. The granddaughter said, "Grandma, you should have heard the preacher. He was really at it today. He was shouting and screaming at the top of his lungs, and people were popping up, and they were praising God and hallelujah. Grandma, you should have seen it." She just kept rocking in her chair. Finally, they said, "Grandma, what do you think of our church?" And Grandma finally rose from her chair and said, "Honey, let me put it this way. I don't care how loud you shout. I don't care how high you jump. It's what you do when you come back down that counts." That's right, friends. It's how we live our lives after we say, "I believe." That's what it means to serve. And God's vision for us, I believe, is that full service station. Well, we're serving in our Christian ed, with our children's ministry, and our students' ministry, and our adult ministry, our singles ministry, our small groups, our preschool. Can you imagine if that's all we did in this facility, this block, is everyone serve each other in this community? Imagine, friends, imagine if every single one of you, every single one of you, and everyone else in this congregation served with their gifts and their passions and their interests. What it would look like. But I want you to imagine what it would look like if no one did. What if no one did? I'd rather envision every one of us serving. No exemptions. So let me close with this. I think it illustrates what I'm trying to say this morning. There was a little old lady who spent most of her summers just sitting and swinging in an old porch swing that she had on her front porch. Her husband had been gone for several years, and every day her loneliness grew and grew and grew. And so one spring day, she went out to the garage, and she dug out an old rototiller that was covered up with a rusty tub. She'd found a bag of seeds that bore a vine that bore beautiful red flowers. She loved red flowers. And so she decided to grow some flowers. And so with great effort and great excitement, she pulled and she pulled and she pulled, and she finally got the old rototiller running. And there was a block wall, concrete block wall, between her house and the neighbor's driveway. And the blocks were laid in such a way that there was a gap between each block. There was a block, there was a gap, block, gap, and so forth. And the wall ran along the entire length of her driveway, dividing her lot from the neighbor's all the way to her garage. With great effort, she tilled the dirt. Her hands were blistered. Her back ached as she held on to the jarring rototiller. With feelings of accomplishment, she got down on her knees and she carefully planted each of the seeds in rows. And the rains came. And God blessed the seeds, and the sunshine warmed the ground, and they sprouted. And she watched as the vines grew and grew until it completely covered the wall. The wall couldn't be seen. And she sat in her swing and she watched the progress. It gave her great joy, but there were no flowers. A healthy, vibrant vine, but no flowers. And so she said, I planted these seeds because I wanted beautiful red flowers. There's none. I'm going to cut this dumb vine down. So she went to her garden or her garage. She found an old rusty hoe. She sharpened it and she began to chop and cut the vine down. And when she was almost completed, her neighbor drove in. He came to a screeching halt. He ran across the wall and said, ma'am, what are you doing? He said, I know this is your property. It's your vine. You can do with it whatever you want. But why are you cutting it down? She said, it didn't bear any flowers. And without hesitation, he took her hand and he led her across the other side of the wall, where there were hundreds, thousands of beautiful red flowers. The Apostle Paul told young Timothy, he said, command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to serve. I command you, do good deeds, be rich in how you serve. And this way, Paul says, they lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of life that is truly life. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for all that you have given us. We are a blessed people. But God, I think we're a generous people. We want to give. We want to serve. We want to help. Show us where we can get plugged in. Lord, show us how we can help. serve you in this church, that it may be an oasis of hope and love and grace in this world that's filled with so much bitterness and division, hate. Help us to be a beacon of light. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As we close out this morning, whether you stand or whether you sit, as we worship this morning, there's a part in the chorus that talks about, "Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken." And I'll challenge you to go ahead and open up your arms, lift them up to God during that point, and see what He has to tell you.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. In these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully. Your name, your mighty love, stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me. You will be with me.
I say this a lot, but I hope that's your sincerest prayer. I hope that's the prayer of your heart. Here I am, Lord. Here I am. Friends, go. Be blessed. Be a blessing to others. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Have a great week. God loves you. I love you. Take care.
Here I am.